But when we make a full submission of our lives to God, it's everything, public and private, social and sexual. Come on, somebody. That means the kitchen and the bedroom.
Yes, sir.
The prayer closet as well as the living room. Come on, somebody. The TV room and every other room in the house belongs to God. And whatever you do in there, you ought to be doing it to the glory of God. Are you praying with me? But not only is it challenging, but there is a cause. The reason we ought to do it, there is a cause for God expecting us to give everything. Paul says, therefore, by the mercies of God. I said this morning that all of us are here because of God's mercy.
Amen.
It's because of his grace that you got saved. You didn't all have anything to offer God. There was nothing that you bring to the party.
Yes, sir.
God provided everything.
Amen.
He provided everything. He provided the food.
Yes.
He provided the drinks.
Yes.
All you did is show up. Come on, somebody. God provides everything, and we are here out of his grace and because of his mercy. And that's the reason we ought to be glad to give everything back to him. Are y'all praying with me? The Bible says it's simple. We ought to give our whole selves because we don't belong to ourselves anymore. If you are a child of God, the Bible says you have been bought with a price. Jesus paid for you on Calvary's cross. And so now he has the right to determine how you're going to live your life and what your life is going to be about. Are you praying with me? Amen. But not only is there this challenge, not only is there God requiring of us and the cause for us to give unto him, but there is the consecration. Paul says that it's a living sacrifice. In other words, in the Old Testament, they would bring dead sacrifices.
Uh-huh.
They would kill the sacrifice at the altar and then offer it up to God. They would bring a lamb and they would bring a ram and they would bring bullocks and they would bring all these animals and turtle doves and all of that, and they would kill them before the altar and place them on the altar. But God said, I don't want you dead on the altar.
All right.
I want you living on the altar.
Yes, sir.
I don't want a dead sacrifice. I want a living sacrifice. And sometimes I think that we offer God dead sacrifices because we give him what's left over. It's dead. Are you praying with me? It's dead. We give him our years when we can't do nothing else. We can't run with the horses no more. So we gonna walk there, and we can't do nothing else, so I'm coming to church then.
Well,
I wish I had a witness at here. Listen, don't fool yourself. A lot of us are doing what we do because we can't do nothing else.
That's right.
We can't keep up no more.
Well,
are you praying with me?
Right.
But God says, I want the best you got. I want a living sacrifice. I don't want a dead sacrifice. I want something alive. And that requires us to look at four things that are pertinent to this concept of offering God and consecrating to God a living sacrifice. A living sacrifice means that we ought to be on the altar everywhere we go. Regardless of the geographical location, we have the right spiritual disposition. And that spiritual disposition is to do the will of God in our lives, no matter what we're doing, no matter where we are. But not only that, a living sacrifice means a continuous sacrifice. We're not hot and cold, but we're hot all the time.
Amen.
You know, we're not hot. We're not worshiping God when things are going well, and then when things go badly, then they're looking for us. So we can't find you.
All right.
Amen.
All right.
Amen. We're not worshiping God as long as we don't have nothing, and we need God to step in and give us something. As soon as we got it, we go.
Yes, sir.
It needs to be continuous and continual. But a living sacrifice means the body gives up its own desires for the desires of the Lord. Then fourthly, a living sacrifice means an unwavering devotion to serving the Lord. It's not something that we do on Sundays at church only, but it's in everything that we do. It reflects the fact that we are sold out and completely surrendered unto the Lord in our lives. Are y'all praying with me? In every action, in every activity, we should pursue after honoring and glorifying God.
Yes.
Can I help you with this word, pursue? Pursue means that I'm trying, I'm pressing, I'm moving toward becoming the man that God wants me to be. Are y'all praying with me? Becoming the mother that he wants me to be. I'm not satisfied that I'm missing the mark. Yes, I missed the mark, but I ain't satisfied. I'm about to stand here, but I'm on my way to become what Jesus wants me to be. And that takes a decision you need to make. We need to make decisions to honor God with our lives. But not only that, is there the challenge, the cost, and the consecration, but there's also the condition of our sacrifice that we need to consider. The condition of our sacrifice needs to be the best we can offer.
Amen.
And it needs to meet two priorities. First of all, it needs to be an awe-inspiring sacrifice. Scripture says, holy and acceptable unto God.
Amen.
The word holy is a word that brings to mind something that is awe-inspiring. When we see God for who He is, through the Holy Spirit and through the presence of Jesus Christ, it ought to bring a sense of awe. And when we were children, when we came to church, we had an awe about the church. We had an awe. In other words, we believed that it was a special place for a special purpose. And we didn't do anything in the church. Any and everything in the church. We conducted ourselves in the church differently than we did outside. Amen, amen. And because we were taught at an early age, you don't run and play
yes,
in the sanctuary.
Yes, sir.
You don't bring any gum up in here. Amen. You don't treat it like just any other place. It's not a movie theater. Don't bring your popcorn and your drinks up in here. Amen. Because we had an awe. This was God's house. Trying to tell you need to be spooky and scary when you come into the worship place. But what I'm saying is when we come into a relationship with the Lord, it ought to be some awe about His presence in my life. That wherever I go, God is with me. That Jesus, wherever I take this body, I take Jesus with me. Whatever I do with this body, I do it with Jesus with me. I wish I had a witness in there. And there is an awe that inspires us to consider making better choices and decisions about what we do in this body. It ought to be awe-inspiring, but it also be an acceptable sacrifice. Well, the Bible says it ought to be pleasing unto God. Pleasing, acceptable unto God. God ought to be pleased with what we are offering Him in our worship. He ought to be pleased. We ought to consider our worship. We ought to coordinate our worship. We ought to offer our worship with the understanding that just good enough won't do. Because God is the one who is critiquing what we are doing. He is the one that has to accept what we are offering Him. It ought to be acceptable. God is pleased when our lives are totally committed unto Him. Because when we give a totally committed life, it proves God's power in our experience. It shows His glory in our lives. It tells the lost world that whoever Christ touches, that life is different and won't ever be the same because of His presence in that life.
Yes, sir.
But not only is there the worship of God, but there is also the wisdom of God in the text. Verse 2a says, "And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind." Paul moves from dealing with the body to dealing with the mind. And the mind is the root of all of our problems. If we can get our minds together, our bodies will follow suit. Free your mind and the rest will follow. And all of our problems start in the mind. And there are two steps in dealing with this aspect of the mind and the wisdom of God as it revolves around living saved. First of all, in order to do that, we need to reject the mold of the world.
All right.
Paul says, don't be conformed. It means To fashion or to shape. It literally means to mold into formity and conformity. He says, don't be squeezed into the world's way of living, into the world's way of thinking. He says, don't look like, don't act like, don't be like, don't dress like, don't come on somebody, don't live like the world lives. Because the world is diametrically opposed to God's purpose in your life. We need to be different and stay different than the world. A good rule of thought is, if the world loves it, we ought to hate it. If the world has adopted it, we ought to reject it. I wish I had a witness in here. We need to reject what the world is offering. Reject the mold. But not only do we need to reject the mold, we need to redirect the mind. He says, be transformed by the renewing. Is that in your Bible? By the renewing of your mind. Transform gives us our word metamorphosis. It's what happens to the caterpillar when he goes in the cocoon and he comes out. He goes in one way, but he comes out another way. It's a metamorphosis. It's a secret change on the inside that eventually will show up and reflect on the outside. And so we have to redirect the mind, and it gives us this understanding that there is a metamorphosis going on the inside of us. Amen. And what you're looking at as a believer in Christ, I'm just a cocoon. Because on the inside, there's another me that's being formulated by the Holy Spirit and by the presence of Christ in my life. And sooner or later, I'm going to bust out of this cocoon and you're going to see the real me, the me that God has made through Christ Jesus. It's a metamorphosis. He wants to transform us, and he does it by renewing our mind, by redirecting our mind. It happens on the inside so that eventually the flesh will show it on the outside.
Yes.
That's what happens in this transformation that takes place. It affects me on the inside, but eventually what's happening on the inside is going to be manifest on the outside. It's the worship of God. It's the wisdom of God. And then finally, lest I keep you too long, it's the will of God. Verse 2b says, Paul basically tells us that the secret of living saved and living holy, it first deals with worshiping God through sacrifice. By giving our bodies and totally surrendering everything that we are over to Christ Jesus. And then through surrendering our minds and redirecting our minds so that our minds would be stayed on Jesus and those things of God. Are you praying with me? And as we are surrendered, our will, his will becomes clearer to us. As I surrender my desires for the desires of God in my life, as I surrender my will and what I want to happen, and start looking and pursuing after the things that God wants to happen in my life and in my family and in my relationships, all of a sudden God's will becomes clearer to me.
Yes.
All of a sudden where he wants me, what he wants me doing, becomes clearer to me as I surrender my will into his will. And as we surrender our will, his will becomes clearer. And then the path that he wants me to take becomes brighter.
All right.
Are y'all praying with me?